Jane.
Thank you for the invite to speak today. I guess my role today is to give a brief overview of fish ecology and really lead into the exciting innovative stuff that Glenn and Matt are doing. So I'll try and hopefully put the work that they're doing into context. So today I'm going to focus on the Murray-Darling Basin in particular, talk about inland fish that are within the Murray-Darling. And usually when we think about fish in the Murray-Darling, well, a lot of people I speak to think about big Murray cod, golden perch, silver perch, some of the bigger fish that you might find at the end of a fishing line. They're the fish that are certainly talked about in the pubs on Friday night. There's lots of other smaller species that are found around the Murray-Darling Basin. They're fish that aren't that well known, but are just important in terms of the ecology, and they're some of the more threatened fish that you'll find. If you look at the Murray-Darling Basin, I guess as a whole, there's three main regions if you want to look at fish and talk about it in a general sense. There's the Northern Basin, which you'll find north of Menindee, which includes all of the tributaries and extends up into Queensland. There's certain species of fish that are found up there that you certainly don't see down south. There's sort of our region, the Southern Connected Basin, which has been a popular term used in the last few years. That there's species that are found in the Southern Connected Basin that aren't found in the Northern Basin. And there's also this estuarine thing. A lot of people talk about the Murray and the Murray-Darling as an inland system, but it's really terminates in an estuary. So the lower end of the system, it's influenced by seawater, and that's very much reflected in the fish community. So whilst there's some areas of the river that are inland, there's also this estuarine region, and I'll get into that, why that's important later on. If the slide will change, I could talk about this for 7 minutes. Here we go. So if you want to further classify fish, there's a majority of fish that only live in freshwater. They spend their whole life in freshwater. They breed in freshwater as adults. They grow in freshwater as juveniles. They spawn. And there's lots of small fish that do it. There's lots of big fish that do it. Their whole entire life history is dependent on the freshwater part of the river. But not many people think about this, particularly up in the northeast because we're so far away from the ocean. But there are a whole bunch of fish that used to be here that were entirely dependent on the ocean for parts of their life history stage. Congolia, sometimes called freshwater flathead or tupong, which used to extend over the border past Mundjuru. And you've got freshwater eels. I don't know if anyone's ever been to Harvey's Fun Park in Albury, but in one of the tanks there, they've got freshwater eels, short-finned eels that are sitting in the tank there. That would have historically come all the way up from the ocean up to this part of the river. And a funny thing about eels, they spend most of their life in fresh water, but they actually go into the ocean and they swim to Vanuatu to breed. And then the Murray-Darling's a very important part of their life history stage. You've also got some fish that live in the salt water that come into fresh water to breed. And again, they're not very well known. One of those species is lampreys. Now, most people think of lampreys, if they even think of lampreys at all, they see them with their sucker disc mouth stuck to the side of a shark living in the ocean. And not many people know that lampreys migrate, they spend most of their life stuck on the side of sharks drinking blood. But then they will actually swim up the fresh water, and these guys actually breed downstream Yarrawonga in the Murray River. So the juveniles, which are called amices, they spend the first couple of years of their life living in the mud, but they've come all the way from the ocean and they're absolutely dependent on that migration pathway to breed, but spend most of their life in the ocean. The Murray-Darling used to be full of fish, full of native fish. Everywhere you went, the wetlands, the main channels were full of fish. And this is one of the very few photos of what the river used to be like. This is taken just over 100 years ago on the Murrumbidgee by a guy called Anderson who was doing work in wetlands then. I don't expect anyone to read that text, but as I understand, these are going to be posted online. It's a very interesting read. So, one net drag out of one wetland in the Murrumbidgee River netted 30,000 native fish from over 25 species. And he did this along a lot of wetlands back in the early 1900s. And it shows that the system used to be remarkably productive. It didn't matter if you were little fish or big fish, you lived in the wetlands, you lived in the main river channel, and there were thousands of you everywhere. It actually started a project that they called the Utilisation of Nature's Waste, and I love talking about it because back then, when the river was naturally wetting and drying, all of these fish would be in the wetlands and the wetlands would dry out. And at that time, the fish biologists thought that was Mother Nature being very wasteful. So they actually went in, netted all of the fish and stocked them in the main dams upstream. And that's what they thought about fish ecology at the time, but it demonstrates how productive the system used to be. But it's certainly not like that anymore. For a lot of those little fish that used to be in the wetlands, there's a handful. They're all the ones with big red crosses. They haven't been seen naturally where they used to occur for almost 40 years. So the 70s was the last recorded sighting of them. For Macquarie perch, there used to be a very good downstream population, particularly down around Euston Weir. They haven't been seen there for 80 years. So fish are starting to decline. And there's a number of factors for that decline. Commercial fishing was one of them. Early on, there was a lot of cod taken out of the rivers and a lot of other species as well. There was even those lamprey, those blood-sucking fish that come from the ocean. There was a commercial fishery for lamprey at one stage. But Murray cod, you see these here. One of the things about Murray cod is they're a very long-lived species, and a lot of those fish that are hanging up there could be 40 or 50 years old. And so it's a big impact when you take a lot of fish that are very old out of the system in a very short period of time. We didn't really understand at the time the impact it was having because it was such a productive fishery. But that's a plot there of the Murray cod commercial fishery. There was a very strong commercial fishery for cod, and it drove inland communities for a long, long time. But they declined around about 1960s and never really recovered. And it wasn't until these statistics were plotted in the 1990s that we actually knew what was going on, and it led to the eventual closure of the fishery. We just weren't very good at managing the fishery and looking at the impacts on it. We just thought that it's going to be productive and going to be productive forever. Developing the basin, that's been great. We've been able to use a lot of land for agriculture, but unfortunately it does block fish migrations, and a lot of the dams and weirs that you see here on this map block migrations. And have led to the decline, particularly of the migratory species. Things like lamprey that need those long distance migrations can't do them unless the river's flooding. Drought, it's a funny thing that fish need water, and if fish don't have water, you don't have any fish. It's a funny thing that you need to understand the impacts of drought, and if you're going to be resilient and survive through a drought, you need remnant water holes, you need refuge. If you don't have refuge, this is what will happen. But as much as fish need water, it needs to be good quality water. If you have water that's no good, it's no good for the fish. And unfortunately, you go from drought to flood. That fantastic graph that Dale put up earlier, which showed we went from one extreme to the other, was too much for the system. There was a huge influx of carbon in 2011, and it led to a huge black water event. All the way probably from the end of a cool system down over the South Australian border, over 100,000 fish died, and pictures like this were everywhere. You're talking about big fish here, 30, 40 years old, all wiped out because of poor water quality. We've also got alien species. We're going to hear from Matt after talking about carp. It's just a graph there showing how quickly carp spread around the basin. It all happened within a space of 30 or 40 years from a very, very small introduction. They were helped out by a couple of big floods in the 70s, and they just took off at the basin scale. But it's not just carp that are the issue. We've got little fish here, like weather loach, goldfish, redfin. Redfin carry a virus which can be transmitted to native fish. And mosquito fish. You see these little fish swimming around almost in every single farm dam you'll find mosquito fish, and they all have impacts on other fish. It's not a great time to be a naked fish in the Murray-Darling Basin. It's pretty close to bottom. You'll hear the figure used that native fish are at 10% of pre-European levels. For some species, it's 0%. They're already gone from areas where they used to be very abundant. And so there's a lot we need to do to help bring them back. But there's a lot that's being done. In the last 20 years, it's seen a real boom in kicking things along. One thing that I was proud to be involved with is the Sea to Hume project. That was actually successful in restoring fish migration routes all the way from the Coorong at the Murray mouth up to Hume Dam. So last year was the first time ever that a fish could theoretically swim all the way from the ocean back up to Hume Dam. And those fish, those lamprey that we talked about, were one species where there was a huge mass upstream migration of those fish. It's the first time that had been seen in almost 40 years. So it's starting to work. Re-snagging. There's been a lot of efforts. Snags were taken out of the river historically so that it improved things for navigation. Unfortunately, that decreased habitat. It was interesting to hear Dale talk earlier about the fluctuating habitat and how that impacted fish, terrestrial animals, but it's the same for fish. So you put the habitat back, you hopefully bring the fish back. In some areas, the fish are that far gone that they can only come back if we help them out. And so restocking programs have been a cornerstone of fisheries management for over 50 years now. So breeding fish and putting them back in is a good way to help them come back quickly. Eradicating pests, a lot of talk about carp control, but it's not just about carp, it's also about all the other pest species that are having impacts. And so there's been a lot of work done in recent times, and Matt will talk a lot more detail about what's going to be done for carp. And eat water. Whether you like or loathe water, it's great for fish because it does do good things. It helps provide spawning cues. It helps provide refuge habitat. It helps provide access to habitat that fish really need. So environmental water has been really done some great things for fish, and there's some really good results kicking around showing the benefits that have really been produced for fish. The question is, there's so many different management tools that are available. There's so much that's needed to be known about fish, and there's limited resource and limited funding. And so the challenge for natural resource managers and researchers is to try to use all of these different tools that you can use for fish, bring them together in some coordinated way and help bring things back for the future. And this is a nice segue into Glenn and Matt's talk, because they're going to be talking about some really innovative stuff that's underway at the moment to help